Okay, hello everybody, and a very warm welcome from us for this third in the webinar on communication for development, where we today is going to specific look at communication for development in conflict and emergency and fragile settings. My name is Annette Beyer-Forschendahl, and I will moderate this session that will be facilitated by Violeta Cuyucaro, and will also be given input by Irina Decoy, who would in a moment give the welcome on the behalf of the Center of Excellence. Just before we start, just a few housekeeping. So if you have not been with us for the previous webinars, you know how to use this platform. So we do have translation in English and French. So if you go down to your left-hand corner, you can see that that's where you find your language selector, where you can either select the English or French translation. I would also like to say that up in your left-hand corner, it's saying live video and presentation. That's where you can either see the live photos, or if you click presentation, there you'll be able to see the presentation. So as soon as we put the presentation on, you can switch between those two modes. But most importantly, we would very much like you to engage throughout the section. The session. So Violeta has a couple of questions for us, and there's also going to be time for questions and discussion afterwards. So you need to here on your right hand corner in the button, there's something called saying request to speak. That's where you have to press if you would like to go on to the floor and ask a question. You're also very welcome to ask questions in the commentary, like in the chat that is here called messaging. So you can just put a message there, and then I will pass on the question for Violeta or Irina. So with those few words, I would just like to give it over to Irina Deco to give us the opening speech. Irina.
Thank you so much, Annette, and welcome colleagues to this third webinar and most exciting one, because it deals with a thematic area which have not been exploited by the CRVS community into the last years, meaning most exactly that albeit there were emergencies at country levels, perhaps at regional level, and sometimes at global level, like the one we are living now, the COVID-19 pandemic, little to none has been done to engage with communities, engage with governments and the decision makers to ensure that services are used, there is demand for services, and everybody is protected and counted during these emergencies, in fragile situations, or in conflict settings, even more so because they need to be more protected and they need to be also counted for improved aid delivery. And if we know the population dynamics in this crisis, we are going to better understand how to deliver aid, when to deliver aid, and who needs aid. So we would respond better to this Leave No One Behind 2030 agenda. I'd like to focus a little bit and discuss the importance of communication for development, social and behavior change in conflict, emergencies, and fragile settings, and perhaps post-conflict. And I'd like to share with you a couple of examples, most notably two examples from my own experience, one from Cambodia and the other one from Côte d'Ivoire, most recent from Côte d'Ivoire. I'm going to start with the Cambodian one, and I think that this one is really relevant for how to engage with the communities and with the governments, and what is the role of communication, how communication could contribute to demand creation. and share with you about the conflict, about the situation in Cambodia. So perhaps you know Cambodia is a country in Southeast Asia who has faced civil wars during the Khmer Rouge regime, sometimes into the 70s, and the war with the neighbor Vietnam until the beginning of the 1990s. In this civil massive unrest, about 3 million people have died and disappeared. But most importantly, people have come to hide their identities because the regimes were looking for intellectuals, they were looking to know who you are, what your diplomas are, where you were born, and so on. So people destroyed civil documents, they destroyed diploma, or they have hidden them wherever they have found the most, you know, safe place. At the end of the war in 1990s, and so the country has gone to elections, and in the beginning of the year 2000, with support from a very large stakeholder, which is the Asian Development Bank, they have decided to put in place a civil registration and vital statistics systems countrywide, which has begun to roll out in 2002. And surprise, from 2002, in a population of about 12 million, most exactly 11.8 million, only 131,000 births have been registered. So why such a void? It was presumed, with a little support from Plan International, that this was the fear factor that was coming into consideration, that the collective memory of a nation was preventing them to go towards the services to register their vital events, be it birth or marriage or the death of the loved ones, because they were fearful that the government might use this again against them into the near future. So how do we overcome the fear factor? How do we work with the communities in emergencies when this fear factor is present? And how do people take decisions? You know, what are the key factors? Who are we there to, you know, work with or support with in such situations? So with Plan International, we have put together a very big communication program. It's at that point of time, almost 20 years ago, it was called Public Awareness and Awareness Raising, Public Information and Awareness Raising Program. And we have proceeded to a massive, massive campaign to campaign. Again, it's a campaign mode to change behaviors and make people go towards the services. So in a space of 4 months, investments were made and about 6,000 community meetings took place. Millions of posters were printed. The TV and the radio were broadcasting PSAs on a regular basis to make people go towards the services. And I'm not saying that all this was due to to communication, but what I'd like to say is that communication contributed to demands of the services. And into the first 2 months of the campaign, 2.1 million people were registered. So this is an example from Cambodia. Now, most recently, Cote d'Ivoire has faced a civil war into the first decade of this millennium. And this war was around l'Ivoirité, who is or who is not Ivorian. And countries was shared practically in two with checkpoints where civil registration documents, births in particular, were requested and destroyed by those who were at the checkpoints. Massive campaigns were done by the government to register about 7 million people, which is not really a small amount. So again, let's say that civil registration was at the core and at the heart of a war, and it has taken years, about 6, maybe more years, for the government to support restoring confidence into these services and determine people to go and demand them. Now, how this was done? Of course, with communication, of course, with a lot of advocacy from the government and with other things put in place. But what I'd like to say was that, you know, a whole reconciliation national process had to take place into this. Now, What we are assisting now at the global level in terms of the emergency is that people behave in a different way. We do have the fear factor. Some of the services have not remained open during at the very beginning of COVID-19. People have not used the services because they were fearing for their lives or because beloved ones were dying at home. So life was taking, you know, a major step on starting above use of the services. All this to say is that the human being and the communities, be it the community of the government or the community into a remote area of Nigeria or into the Congos of the world, behave differently under stress. What we are going to see today with Violeta, it is how to harness the power of the community, the power of communication, social and behavior change to increase and maintain demand for services in critical circumstances, in particular where civil registration is most important than into the normal crisis. And I'm going to leave the floor to Violeta now to walk us through and just intervene where it is needed. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Irina. Can you hear me well?
Yes, we can hear you well.
Thank you. Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening, colleagues. I will try now to open my presentation to share the screen with you. As you know, we are now, Yes, it's here. I'm sharing it now. And we will have the full screen. Can you see the presentation now?
Yes, we can see the presentation.
Great. As it was said already by Annette and Irina, it's a third webinar of a series of webinars on social and behavior change communication based on the new handbook on communication for development for CRVS systems, developed by UNDS with the support from Center of Excellence. And this particular topic, communication in emergencies and fragile settings, is not yet part of this handbook, is being developed, but we consider it very important for our work. So we decided to discuss it today with you. What we would like to have as a result after this session is to learn and be aware of how we should change our communication planning and implementation in emergencies and in fragile settings. What would mean communication preparedness in this case? And few important features of communication in emergencies, which are feedback mechanisms and accountability to affected population, and rumors management. And we hope this will help you also share some insights and lessons learned with your teams, and to be able also to seek specific technical support when you need to strengthen your planning for communication in emergency. What we will have in this webinar, first we would like to have a short recapitulation of the previous two webinars, to remind ourselves few important principles, but also for those who could not participate. We will discuss why we need a specific communication planning for emergency, what is communication preparedness, how do we put in place these feedback mechanisms and social listening mechanisms, and how do we manage rumors, some differences in our communication strategies in emergencies, and also some resources which you can consult later and you can find more information. Speaking about our previous webinars, in the first one we discussed about social and behavior change for CRVS systems, and we said that the demand side is often seen very simplified. We always speak about knowledge, perceptions, attitude, interest, or we speak about whether the services are friendly enough, accessible enough, and we forget that there are a lot of other dimensions, which are skills and abilities, self-confidence, the peers and the family support for people to be able to access these services, the trust of these services, what is the general public narrative, the community action, the community cohesion, the engagement, and the big topic of positive social norms around the registration and so on and so on. So it's much more than just information, knowledge, attitudes, and so on. And we said that in order to address all these levels of demand, we need to work and plan our work according to the socio-ecological model, which puts the person, the family, the parents in the middle, and around we see five layers of influence, larger family, community, institutional and civil society, and political and advocacy level. And in order to address all this level, we need to have strategies which combine a mix of different approaches. So our communication strategy will mix behavior change communication with social change communication, with social mobilization, and with advocacy. And this will address all these five levels of influence. But to have this right mix, we will need to have the right social research. So our communication is not anymore unilateral, based on messages. It's data-driven. It's based on a wealth of social data that we collect in advance and analyze. It's people-centered and community-led. It's based on dialogue, on engaging community. It's very much reinforcing local capacities, because we don't want to work in campaign style to have 3 months of communication and leave after that. We want to create these capacities at national, at regional, at local level. And it's collaborative, because no CRVS system is able to do the communication through a multitude of platforms. We need to work with other sectors, and we need to work with other partners. In the second webinar, we discussed about social norms. And we said that this is a whole new strategy inside our communication strategy. To work on social norms, first of all, we need a specific formative research and analysis that identifies specific things for working on social norms. Then we need the whole theory of change, or conceptual framework, or logic model, whatever you call it, that tells us what are the causal outcomes, activities, assumptions, and so on. And this is not only for communication, this is for the whole program. And it's imperative to have mechanisms to consult with the impacted community, because social norms exist at community level, and we cannot just change social norms by working on national level or in mass media. Therefore, partnering with those institutions that have mechanisms to reach communities is very important. This can be other organizations, this can be departments or ministries that are in charge of local development, local budgeting. There are many, many institutions and partners that work with communities. We also said that the research on social norms is specific, because we need to ask ourselves few questions. We need to find out what are the beliefs of people about other people's behaviors and expectations. Because we said that social norms exist where we have specific expectation from other people, what they do usually and what they expect of us to do usually. And this is fueling the norms. We will need also to find out the reference network in which these beliefs exist. And we will need to find out what are the reasons for people to act according to these beliefs. So what is the compliance mechanism? What are the sanctions or the encouragement or the rewards for practicing specific behaviors? And also we need to find out the strengths of the norm. And we spoke about the new studies that were published by Learning Collaborative, which show us how to measure the strength of the norm. And why is this important? It's because based on this, we will decide what action to take, what strategy to adopt. And we have four different approaches to norms. First of all, we can decide to fortify the norm if it's a positive norm that supports the behavior that we need. We could decide to reframe the norm, so let it be, but speak about it in a slightly different way so that it becomes more useful to our practice of behavior. Or we might decide to shift the norm, and this is the most difficult and the most radical strategy, when the norm is not beneficial for our practices, and then we decide to change it in order to fit the common interest. And also there might be also norm there that don't bother us in any way, so we just need to be aware of them and not change, not shift, not fortify, just be aware that it exists, and at some moment it might become more important to us. And we also said that there are four stages in changing social norms. First of all, as we said, we need to change those social expectations at community level. And this is a very participatory community level exercise where we want people to see the things differently, to see the norm differently, or to shift this norm. On a second stage, we want this change to make public. We want everybody to know that something is changing, and this will fuel also, will accelerate the change. On a third stage, we will want to build a big environment supportive to this change at higher level, public opinion, at community level, the public narrative, the influencers, everybody should support this environment. And also the policy, the law, and the policy makers and everything. And on a fourth stage, we will evaluate and also evolve. So we will expand beyond the initial communities, starting again with step A, but on a larger scale, because social norms are always starting with a small scale, most at risk, most affected area by this social norm. So this was our recapitulation of our two previous webinars. Today we will speak about communication in emergency or in fragile settings. And I would like to start by asking you, because you expressed your interest for this webinar, why do you need a specific plan for communication in your country, or why do you think this topic is important for you?
So please, if you're interested in answering live, you just need to press the request to speak button in your right hand corner, or you can also respond in the chats. Is there anybody who is interested?
Anybody, or we should move?
There's somebody requesting to speak. We've got Innocent from Congo. Innocent, as soon as you are on the floor, I'm just... Innocent, are you on the floor? Can you unmute?
Do we have Innocent?
I mean, he appears on the request list, but I can't see him on the floor. I'm just I'm getting a message here that Innocent, you must just refresh. How do you refresh, Holly?
Yes, hi. You can refresh your browser and then be let into the meeting again, and make sure that you're using Google Chrome and have allowed the browser to use your microphone and your camera.
Okay.
This might take time, no?
Yeah. So I think we just move on and then we can hear from our participant later. But it's as Holly was just saying, it's important that you use Google Chrome as your browser. Otherwise, it won't allow you to actually use your speaker or your camera. Thank you. Just move on.
Okay, thank you. We'll move on and then we will let Innocent speak later or other volunteers. So we will speak today about emergencies, which are the situation which pose threat to our life, health, property, environment of the whole population or a part of population, or has already caused loss of life, or has a high probability of escalating to cause danger to our life, health, property, or environment. And there are many, many, many types of emergencies. Here we put epidemics and pandemics first because we are living one of these pandemics now. And why is it important? Is because it showed us that not only those organizations that respond to this pandemic need to plan their emergency communication. Every service, every institution had to adjust its communication to this situation because the situation changed and we cannot anymore do business as usual. The fragile settings is a country or a territory which population faces overlapping, interconnected challenges. Each of them brings a new risk. So when this risk accumulates at some point, population can lose the contact with services or can not access their basic needs. And this is very important to us because we are in a situation when many countries in our regions are facing now this overlapping challenges. There are many, many definitions. We will not speak about all of them, but you can see I presented here a few of them. So you can maybe find your own way of understanding it, but they don't differ so much. Why we need a different communication planning for emergency? First of all, because provision of services is very often disrupted or changed. So we need to inform communication of this population of these changes as soon as possible. But there is also disruption of usual ways of communication. We cannot do any more the same communication. We need to find new sources, new channels, new influencers, and so on. Also, during an emergency, there is a big drop in the trust levels of population. Population is on the moving ground. It's a crisis. You don't know whom to trust, whom not to trust. And sometimes services are also seen as something coming from institutions that are not to be trusted. As I said, there are new information sources in these situations. And what is very important, there are a lot of rumors, misinformation, and disinformation. And this poses a big risk to the image of our organizations and of our services. Also, in any crisis, the inequities will widen. Those who are vulnerable or stigmatized will be even more vulnerable and stigmatized because people are fighting for survival in a way. Also, we lose access physical to some group of population. There might be movement restrictions. And also because we need a more reactive communication. We cannot plan anymore in advance, 3 months from now, I will communicate on this. We need to be very reactive and inform population on changes in services and other things immediately. And as you saw, for example, in this pandemic, there might even be physical distancing measures, which will not allow us to have face-to-face communication as we had before. On the other hand, and Irina spoke about this in the introduction, during emergencies, we need the people to have basic document because this will help them avoid risk of child separation or will protect them from exploitation, trafficking, even recruitment in armed group in some regions. Also, it will allow displaced person to access aid or governmental facilities. It will contribute to the freedom of movement. People will be able to move if necessary, and also will help them claim housing, land, property, and many other reasons why we need to keep the services going on, and that's why we need a good communication plan which will support this. There are a few stages of communication in emergencies. Sometimes people speak about 4 stages, sometimes about 5. In big lines, we have, first of all, we have preparedness. When we assess the situation, we prepare ourselves to do this communication differently in a fragile setting or in an emergency. So we will speak about it a little later. When the emergency starts, the communication is very specific. We need rapidly to establish credibility of our organization, of our spokesperson, of our services. We will do this with simple communication on changes, on procedures, on access to services, and we will recommend what are new actions. We are not those who respond to the emergency. We are not, for example, in this pandemic, we are not those who tell people what are the protective measures, but we have also our role to tell people how to use our services in this new situation and how to remain protected by using our services and so on. On the next stage, when the emergency is more advanced, we will need to maintain our communication and it will also change a lot. So now we will have more time to capture the feedback, analyze it. We will have more time to address rumors. We need to engage communities because, as we already discussed in previous webinars, our communication, if we want it to be efficient, it should engage population and be developed together with the communities. And we will be able to provide more background to our communication, more explanations, arguments. There is also a stage when we are getting out of this crisis. So it's during the recovery and post-crisis, when we again need to explain the changes, the transition, but we also have time to capture the lessons learned, and this will serve us to improve our future preparedness. What would be the important characteristic of our communication in emergency? First of all, it should be nationally led and it should be coordinated. We had so many experiences in the past when a crisis strikes and every organization starts providing its own messaging and according to its own vision. And this creates even more misunderstandings, more misinformation and more rumors. In a crisis, it's very important that everybody speaks the same language and this communication is coordinated. So this is something we should not underestimate. As we said before, informed by data, new data, because our previous research will not give us everything. The situation changed, the population moved, the needs are different. There are new issues which didn't exist before. So having rapid assessments or other research is extremely important when we prepare to an emergency or during the emergency, because emergency also is something evolving, changing, and we will need new data all the time. It's very important that our communication nurtures trust. It's open and transparent. And the main element of this will be the feedback mechanism, which will be discuss later. It's very important that the communication is community-centered and participatory, because we want to work with the knowledge, with capacities of the communities, and we also want to enable them to take actions. We need to work on dispelling misinformation and disinformation, and this is rumors management. And this is inherent in any crisis situation. So that's why we will spend so much time today on this. And as we said, in a crisis, those who are vulnerable become even more vulnerable and marginalized. So our communication should be as inclusive as possible. The main strategic axis of a communication plan, we already discussed in the previous webinars. For the emergency, it will be a little different. So we will have new axes such as communication preparedness and feedback mechanism, accountability to affected population, management of rumors. But even in other cases, like, for example, social mobilization or social change communication, we will have differences in the way we do it in emergency. And the first strategic axis of our communication plan will be communication coordination. We already discussed that the handbook on communication for development for CRVS systems recommends to have a separate CRVS communication office, which is not a media person, which is an office that plans strategically long-term communication for behavior and social change. In an emergency, this office will have also new tasks. It will coordinate preparedness, rapid situation assessment. It will review and approve the emergency plan, mobilize additional resources. In an emergency, usually we have additional resources which are coming for emergency. And also will coordinate the putting in place the feedback mechanism and rumors management. We also discussed the multi-sectoral coordination on CRVS communication, and we said that it's very important to work with other sectors such as health, education, justice, with civil society and others in a coordination committee. And this committee also will help us not to have, as we said before, a multitude of different messages and contents going around. It will help us have a better reach through different platforms, but also to speak the same language and address population in a coordinated way. And the plan for emergency or fragile settings will clarify the approaches, what and how we will communicate, through what media, what people and resources, who will need more information, and so on. It's very important, it's crucial to know that any plan for communication and information in emergency should be consistent with whatever disaster management plan are carried out by national authorities, and we already explained this. So, to speak about preparedness, I think it's clear why we need it. We already said shortly. We need it for three reasons. First, to anticipate the crisis and minimize the impact of this crisis on our services, on the image of our institution. and on the population, first of all, because there will be economic cost, there will be social cost for the population. So we want this disruption in timely civil registration to be anticipated. We want to manage the communication risk. We don't want our CRVS system to fail, to be totally disconnected from the population, or to become to be a victim of some image or communication failure. And we want to put in place whatever resources we need so that we can act rapidly in case of emergency. So we want, and we will speak later about these resources, we want to be prepared. So what would be the main activities in this communication preparedness plan? First of all, the rapid assessment and any other research that we decide it's important. We will define the risk for disrupted civil registration, what are most at risk population or areas, what are the new information and communication needs. We will have three major mappings, and don't consider it too much because they are all important in their own way and they are different. We cannot put them together and have just one mapping, because the mapping of partners will show us who are those partners that can activate in those at-risk area, what each of them can do, which role can take, which responsibility can take. And these are not always our usual partners. Maybe we never worked with some organization, but now in this new settings, fragile setting, or in this new emergency, we discover that this partner has access to population and we don't have. The mapping of communication networks is different because this shows us who are those networks at local level who have access to population. Maybe we never worked, for example, with women's associations, but now in this new situation, these women are the best to communicate with families or other local networks. So it will be a different mapping. And the mapping of media, including online media, which is pertinent for at-risk areas and which can help us bring our messages or communicate with population or engage population. After having identified all these resources, we need to prepare some standby partnership agreements, meaning that we discuss the potential, we discuss and put on paper and agree on the potential activity while the emergency starts, so that when we need it, we activate by one signature or one button, we activate this agreement and we start immediately the activities. It's very important to discuss and agree together with all partners on procedures for information and materials. What are the validated procedures? How we will share all these materials? Who will design, who will produce, who will distribute, and most importantly, how we will all agree that this is what we want to distribute. The same about monitoring. During especially an emergency or in a fragile setting, we will not start going on all of us into communities to monitor the activities. We will need to share the responsibilities, roles, and do it together. So we will need specific procedures, and we will need specific capacity building, because in emergency we will need, for example, maybe to train hotline operators, so we will need to train people in collecting rumors or many other new skills that we will need in an emergency situation. What is this feedback mechanism that we speak about? First of all, it's not compliance. It's not about addressing compliance. You know, very often this image of a feedback mechanism was linked to some box which is put somewhere in an office and people throw in notes with their compliance and then nobody ever sees these notes. And this caused us a lot of prejudice because feedback mechanism is not about collecting compliance, it's much more. It should build trust between us and communities. It should generate a lot of information from the community for our planning. It should enhance the way we engage communities and it should improve our communication. And don't forget that we are accountable to population and to, especially in the emergency situation, we are accountable to affected populations. So the return, the whatever action and whatever response we give to communities is even more important than the complaints that we take from them. So feedback mechanism has two halves, what population needs and what CRVS system needs. For population, it's important to be heard and to be understood, to be respected. It's important that we show that we respect the population. It's important that there are rapid actions that are taken in response to their complaints and feedback. Also, there should be explanations of things we do, of way we reorganize the services or plan to reorganize the services. And whenever there is the need, population also need our apologies for the things that went wrong or we did wrong. But we as a CRVS system or supporters of the CRVS systems, we also need this feedback mechanism because it helps us identify problems with services, with demand for services. It helps us improve service delivery when it doesn't exist or when it should be done differently and so on. We need also to have a recording system to capture these complaints. It's not just receiving them, it's capturing and analyzing. And we need a clear delegation of procedures for staff on dealing with this feedback, and also a very clear mechanism to provide action and remedies based on this feedback. So some questions that we want maybe to ask population would be, what are they worried about in relation to civil registration services in this new situation? How are the services responding to their needs? Do they have any questions about our services that are not answered? There will be a lot of questions about what they misunderstand about services, what are their concerns, and so on. Rumors, we will not ask directly what are the rumors, we will see later how we ask it. What are they not used, why are they not using, in some cases, the services? What should we do differently to adjust to their needs, and so on. So the feedback mechanism will have three components: enabling compliance and feedback, responding to them, and learning from this compliance to change the services and to have clear accountabilities for handling them and stimulating the improvement of CRVS system. What would be the possible sources of this feedback? It will be depending on the situation. There are a multitude of ways of collecting this feedback, but the ways should be very clearly established in the mechanism. So community leaders might provide on behalf of communities. Everybody who is frontline worker, community mobilizer, registers, should have clear way of providing this feedback to the feedback mechanism. A representative of community networks and community-based organizations, The mechanism should be the same for all partners, and it's important to have partnership with those organizations that are trusted by communities and by at-risk groups. Don't forget that we don't collect feedback just from majority, from main group. From we also need at-risk groups, minority groups to have this point of contact with our feedback mechanism. All interactive community radio programs are a good way of collecting this feedback, but it should be registered again. Hotlines are a great way of collecting the feedback. Community meetings and meetings of any CRVS representative with communities. Setting up a feedback mechanism, so we said it has two sides, feedback, receiving feedback and providing action or response. So, first of all, we need to be sure that organization commits to this, because it's not just a way of sending, we collect feedback. It's a mechanism that should be created and put in place, which means somebody needs to support it and budget for it and budget for training human resources and so on. Then we need to consult the population on preferred approach. Maybe they don't like some of our ways of collecting this feedback. I'm sorry. Are we still in the presentation? Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay, sorry. So we need specific feedback mechanism guidelines, and we need to agree on roles and responsibilities for each action in this feedback mechanism. We need to set it and train the staff for this, and to inform the community on how we will provide, they will provide feedback and how we will respond to it. On the other side, we need to acknowledge the receipt of this feedback, enter it into database, investigate. We will speak later about some of the investigation, mostly about rumors. And we need to resolve formally or informally this situation. And very important is to respond back to community, because this is the action that will build the trust and will help us interact with the community. And everything should be recorded. Responses, changes, and shared for further learning. I will give you just two examples. One is from Congo. I think colleagues who are here online from DRC Congo know very well about it. And it was very recently, 1-2 years ago, the latest Ebola outbreak in North Kivu. The feedback mechanism was developed in coordination by all Ebola response partners, and they shared the same dashboard, which was showing the action taking on feedback, and this actually played a tremendous role in responding to Ebola outbreak, because as you know, in the beginning there was very little trust, if at all, between the response actors and the population. So the response was extremely difficult. These complaints and feedback were analyzed. And it's important to say that it's not a communication feedback and complaints. It's for every pillar of the response. So for sanitation, for safe and dignified burials, for vaccination, for management of sick people. The mechanism was covering the whole response. And the strategic coordination meeting was looking every week on this dashboard of the feedback mechanism and seeing which pillars took action and which didn't take action on the feedback. The sources of feedback were very, very diverse. Dialogue with communities, interpersonal communication, monitoring of community incidents, because as you know, there were a lot of community incidents, especially related to surveillance, to dignified burials, to vaccination. Social research, we already discussed in our previous webinars that there was a big social research group working permanently. Through interactive radio programs, social media, meetings with community actors, but also reports from all frontline workers, not only communicators, but also vaccinators, those working on sanitation and so on. And other channels, for example, meetings with parents in school or field supervision and so on. So this feedback mechanism played a great role in the Ebola response. The second example is more recent, and it's from our present pandemic. It's from Eastern and Southern Africa, where at least five countries for the moment, Comoros, Kenya, Madagascar, Malawi, and Zambia, share this social listening programming. So social data is gathered through a variety of channels. Again, radio, hotlines, SMS, face-to-face SMS platforms, face-to-face communication, meetings, and so on and so on. And then there is the interagency working group that has a framework to code, to analyze, and triangulate all this data to inform the response to the pandemic. And these insights are very important for planning both behavior change communication, but also program delivery. And I use several mechanisms that contribute to this feedback mechanism to the database. There is community feedback, which comes from a lot of inputs. There is digital dimension of online platforms, social media, instant messaging application. You see here on the image, you see the U-Report, for example, the Internet of Good Things, and many other platforms. And then there is data from primary research, which is triangulated with feedback coming from community and from social media. So there are many examples, and you probably have your own examples, which we will be happy to hear after we finish this webinar. For the moment, we will pass to rumors, and maybe this time we will manage to hear from you also. We would like to hear from you some examples of rumors about civil registration that you learned through your professional experience or in your country.
So, Violeta, we still have Innocent for DRC Congo. So we would very much like, you unmute so we can hear your feedback and your comment?
Innocent?
Innocent, are you there? Is it possible you can just press the unmute? Oh, now he's off the...
Okay, maybe somebody else?
Is somebody else interested? You will have to press the request to speak button that is on your right-hand corner of the screen. Yes, we have somebody. This is Anik. Remember, Anik was with us last time as well. Anik, please go ahead and unmute.
Okay, thank you. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
I will continue in French.
Okay.
Recently in January, we had a study. We took a study in the framework of the acceptance regarding the vaccine against coronavirus in Senegal. Let's say it was joint research between the Lattes and committee reunite where scientists meet and they try to work on how vaccination programs are accepted by the population. So I actually found myself in the different steps. And first, we had to assess an initial research as a reference to have a feedback on why people were very wary about the vaccine, and very often we touched upon the rumor factor, and many things came up, like populations were really very wary. There was the conspiracy theory, the intervention of the Westerners towards the African populations, and especially, more specifically. And so we had to somehow deconstruct those rumors about vaccination and especially this vaccine against COVID-19. There were many things, as Violeta, you just gave us. We were able actually to have that study taken out, not for people to buy the vaccine, but it's still the whole process goes on, because our decision makers, our president, were actually vaccinated. So that's a step, so that a population now start to accept. But our study still goes on, so that we could actually have the acceptance in Senegal regarding the coronavirus. Yeah, very interesting. This conspiracy theory is all over the place, and we are going to talk about this deconstruction.
Rumors. If not, should I continue?
Yeah, maybe you should just continue. Okay. So next time there's an opening, we will let Anik come on again. And also, still innocent, if you would like to make your comment, you're very welcome to request to speak, and then you can speak in a few minutes again.
Okay, thank you. So we will discuss a little about the rumors. Rumors are information that is not verified and that is interesting, so it spreads rapidly through groups of population. It can be true or it can be false, and often in a rumor we have a little bit of both, a little of true, a little of false, and we need to understand that they are a natural response to uncertain times or threatening times. Why do people share rumors? There are different motivations. For example, maybe people try to explain an event or a situation, and without wanting, they start spreading a rumor. Or they feel that they want to share some entertaining information or useful information. Maybe they want to show oneself as a knowing person, or make others look bad. They want to make relationship using information. They want to feel connected to issues that affect them. Or sometimes, yes, it's true, people want to mislead or deceive, and often they do it because it's a political motivation or economical motivation. And with the exception of disinformation, people usually share rumors because they believe them. They believe the rumor or part of this rumor. And a crisis alters how people assess the accuracy of these rumors because their networks are disrupted, their usual sources of information are disrupted, and they want to understand what is happening around them. So they sometimes believe things in a way that they would not do in a normal situation. When they are going through a crisis, they feel threatened, they feel fear, and their capacity for critical thinking and assessing how accurate is this information is also decreasing. So we said that rumors are a natural response to uncertain times. What is important for us is to look at those rumors that are misinformation or disinformation. So misinformation is incorrect information spread by people without the intent to deceive. For example, they misunderstand, honestly misunderstand. Disinformation is incorrect information that is spread in order to deceive or to manipulate others. And rumors very often are born from the wish. For example, they reflect the hopes of the community. Somebody can say, oh, I heard that authorities will distribute humanitarian aid only to families with more than 5 members. So let's better not register the death of one of family members to have these 5 members. So people want something, and this rumor will spread very rapidly, actually, in a normal situation. Other rumors can be born by fear. And this is the most prevalent way the rumors spread, because they are born from the anxieties of the population. For example, an example that I invented, maybe it's true, maybe not, the rebels might abduct single woman from the village, so better let's not register the death of the husband. So you will be more protected if you remain in the same family. Hostility rumors reflect the threats to the community or prejudices against other group. For example, the Syrian refugees get better services than local population. These are just few examples, and I'm sure you know more than this, but why we cannot ignore these rumors? First of all, because sometimes they provide feedback on our program. We find out what is not communicated enough or what is not done well. But even more, we cannot ignore because they can create suffering, because they can threaten lives, because they are undermining the efforts that are taken by humanitarian organizations. We can't ignore them because they also help us better understand people in these communities. And they can serve to us as an early warning on future violence or risky behaviors in this area. But also because we are responsible to communities as partners of the core humanitarian standards. And more recently, there are also interagency commitments on accountability to affected populations. So we are all in our roles responsible in front of the communities. The action on rumors will have 3 steps: listening, verifying, and engaging with population. First step on listening, we need to know that rumors can be spread in different ways. It can be word of mouth, online, media. And listening to these rumors is more than just hearing what was said. To effectively listen to rumors, we need to build a trusted relationship and trusted ways to listen to the population. We need to ensure that we can listen in the language of the community. So we have partners, so we have members of the team who are able to listen in the language of the community and to have open conversation with the community, but not formal conversation, unstructured, where people start saying things that are not usually said otherwise. And we should be keep in mind that people might be reluctant to share rumors with people that they do not trust. So partnering with civil society, with local media, with community-based group, with teachers and other frontline workers is very important to help us listen to this rumor and track the rumors. If you have the resources, it's very important to create a platform, for example, a toll-free hotline, a website, a social media page, or an email address, where the public can call in or write with rumors for clarification or reporting. You might need also to train people who are listening to rumors to make sure that they know what kind of information you are looking for and why, so that they can explain this to the community. Listening, as we said, is much more than just hearing. It involves understanding of the specific group that we are listening to, of their concerns, of the issues they face. And people might decide what information they share according to their own priorities, not our priorities. Identifying rumor doesn't mean asking people about any rumor that they have heard, because they might not think it's a rumor. So if you ask, oh, have you heard of any rumors, they will say no. We need to find other way to have the discussion in a way that we discover what they think about services and so on. We need to have a rumors log. And this rumors log is more than just what the rumor is. It's the source, the date, the location, the potential consequences, and we will speak about this, the risk rating, and the verification and the following activities which we take based on these rumors. Understanding what triggered the rumor, where it is coming from, gives us the opportunity to address the causes, not just the reply to the rumor itself. For example, sometimes rumor might be born from the fact that we, our organization, has done something or hasn't explained properly something. A rumor may be being spread by a group of influential individuals, so working with this group directly could address the root issues. Maybe they have some specific interests in spreading these rumors. Rumors can also illustrate, as we said, stress or anxieties of people. And then you need to understand where it is coming from and address these concerns. There are things to consider also. We need to be very careful when addressing rumors, not to spread another rumor or not to reinforce this rumor when trying to verify it. So at this stage, when we are listening, we need to spend time on assessing how the rumor starts, but not stress it too much again so that we reinforce it. The next step, we said we will speak about assessing the potential consequences. There are a few questions to ask ourselves when we assess about the consequences. We should ask ourselves or people around us, could this rumor cause harm? Could it stop people from accessing our services. Could it cause conflict? Should it be inter-community, intra-community, ethnical or any other conflict? Could it result in risky behaviors for the population? Could it put certain groups of population at risk? Could it put our staff, partners or community at risk? And could it pose a significant reputational risk for our institution and for our system? We said we will speak about verifying, step two, verifying the information. At this step, we need to find out the facts that are behind this rumor. So we need to check the rumor with our reliable information sources. It can be written sources, all the laws, rules, policies, fact sheet, or it could be people with first-hand expertise and who know in depth the subject matter. But we need also to be very, very careful with these people. We need to be sure what are their qualifications, motivations, do they have biases. You don't want somebody's opinion, you want the facts. So it's very important to know that this person is providing us facts. And the facts that we find out, we need to triangulate, which means to check with at least three different sources. And if these sources confirm the same opinion, then it's okay. If not, we need to check with other sources and so on. So this verification process should allow us to know which elements of the rumor are true or untrue. The next stage would be engaging, and engaging will mean finding the key audience to whom we will address the new narrative, who needs to be influenced, through which channels, and what will be this new narrative that will replace the rumor. When you develop a new narrative, it's very important to use the language or dialect of our target group, because this can vary between different groups within a community. For example, groups with lower education level might prefer to speak different languages or dialects compared to well-educated people. And all this is very important when developing our new narrative. We need to use quotes or testimonials from people that that group, that audience trusts and identifies with. So this new content should be pre-tested. This is mandatory with key audiences. And we cannot just simply provide the facts behind the rumor, because the rumor has complex emotional value to people, and we cannot just override it by providing some facts. This new narrative should be compelling enough to replace the original rumor. As we said, the rumors is something juicy, something sexy, something that people like to tell to other people. And we will need to develop a narrative that is also interesting and appealing. So this new narrative will be conveyed through a message or a series of messages, depending on the complexity of the rumor and depending on the context. For example, the message may be something very simple. We add additional information in a frontline worker sessions, or it may require long-term, complex, resource-intensive intervention, for example, a communication campaign. But in any case, it will be delivered through a multitude of channels. Some ways of creating this new content: we need to keep it simple. The facts are more likely to be remembered if they are not drawn in a lot of different other facts and words and so on. We need to use as much as possible the visuals, because images and graphics can be effective in addressing a rumor. we need to express it all in a positive manner, because positive messages are more likely to be recalled and also believed, and to tailor our messages to the target group. Also, it's important to be timely, because a rumor can travel very fast, and our counter message should also be delivered quite fast. And it should include actionable information. What can people do differently when they hear our message? And of course, we need to ensure that our narrative is trusted, attribute the information to a source that is trusted by the community. It's very important also to coordinate or partner with other organizations and groups to when we assess the rumors or when we develop the messages, so that we all speak the same language. Also, it's important sometimes to partner with a media development agency so that the content that is created is user-friendly, jargon-free, and also very appealing. And the last stage would be engaging. So we will find the right communication channels, and we will use more than one channel. And whenever possible, we will have interactive communication. So we will have two-way channels so that people can ask questions, receive answers, check whatever they don't understand. And trust, as we said again, is a critical issue. Should we deliver this new narrative, new message through a channel which is not trusted the population, we will only reinforce the rumors. There are also a few other things to consider. A big question is whether you reference the original rumor or not. And you will find that there are different ways of doing things. Including the original rumors might mean that it's easier to target those people who have heard this rumor and believed it. It also helps you flag this rumor as false and enable people to correct themselves should they hear it again or in the future. But also there are big disadvantages to this, and there are big mistakes that are very often in our media and everywhere. So very often organizations or media reinforce the rumor without wanting to do it or spread further the rumor, because they are citing it and the response is not as strong as the rumor itself, or it's overcomplicated and people hear rumor one more, but they don't understand the response to it, or don't remember the response, or don't understand the response. So in this case, we only reinforce the rumor. If you decide to cite the rumor, you will need to very clearly label it as a rumor and immediately state the facts to counter it, and to counter it in a very simple, appealing, and strong approach. So this is not as easy as we think. There is no correct way. There are organizations who reference the rumors, there are organizations who don't. But those that reference should be very strong in their response. For example, you know the experience of Internews that uses direct citation, but their response is also very strong, and it's very clear that they are responding to false information. An alternative approach is to frame the rumor as a question, which helps us raise the issue without the fear of spreading the rumor. So there are organizations, for example, now in COVID, that ask, is it true that da-da-da-da-da? And after that very clear answer, no, it's not true, and so on. Reformulated positively the answer. So these are very important things to consider when addressing the rumors. What we shouldn't do is ignore rumors, reinforce rumors, spread other non-confirmed information when we want to reply to rumors, and leave some parts of the questions or questions unanswered. If we don't know something, it's better be honest and say that we don't know, what we will get the information and we'll get back to you with this information, because otherwise we might again create new rumors. To give you an example of the cost of not listening, it's the 2003 example of Nigeria, when there was a boycott of the polio vaccination campaign. So there were very insistent rumors going around that the polio vaccine is contaminated with HIV, it's anti-fertility, cancerogenic, so and so on. And we know that these rumors we meet very often in the countries when we speak about any vaccination, including, as Anik told us today, about Senegal, about COVID vaccines. So this brought to a political and religious boycott in 5 Nigerian states. It was an 11-month boycott of polio vaccination. And the cost of not listening to these rumors, and especially not addressing them rapidly, was very high, was extremely high. So the polio cases increased in Nigeria, but also spread to 18 countries across 3 continents. And the estimated cost was around $500 million of all this response to come back to the initial situation. And this boycott was only resolved after a very big concerted international effort that costed a lot. So this Nigerian political and religious leaders were sent to South Africa, India, Indonesia to see the vaccine in use and see that it's safe. The meetings with the religious leaders brought about the fact that the vaccines are produced in Indonesia and under the in an Islamic state, and it doesn't come from outside the religion also. So there were many efforts, and these efforts were not in Nigeria also, but it had to be done in the whole region, in Chad, Cameroon, Niger, Togo, Benin, Burkina Faso, and many other countries. And you see in the photo recent from 2018 meeting, polio review meeting, which is chaired and organized by emirs in these states. So this was just an example to show how not listening to rumors can prejudice our programs. So we are approaching actually the end of our webinars. Just shortly about how other communication activities will change during emergency. When we speak about community engagement, it's very important during emergency, because communities and people will already be adapting locally, will find their own mechanism to cope with the emergency. And we need to understand this mechanism and support them. Therefore, the discussions group become very important. People might already have developed measures of their own, which might be more appropriate to their local context than we will design, and we can support these community-led initiatives. We should make sure that messages are coming directly from respected community members, even more than in development, because the trust in emergency becomes much more important than in development situation. And these trusted sources can be identified by these rapid assessments that we discussed before. The work with community leaders itself might change in emergency, because, as we said, we might not have physical access, or community meetings cannot be possible. So the new WhatsApp groups, Facebook groups, and other groups become very important when they are leaded by community leaders and community organizations. And the communication can pass through these groups. You might want to provide some budget for mobile phones, and all your online information to these groups. The social media becomes very important in emergency and in fragile settings, and you can consider using it to discuss ideas, you can work with the moderators of this group to correct misconceptions, to track rumors, to post videos and a variety of multimedia formats to attract more attention online. So there can be, as we said, Facebook groups, WhatsApp groups, but also online video, live chats, questions and answer sessions, even Facebook live sessions. And also there are a lot of new platforms, for example, Internet of Good Things, which provides information on emergencies in areas which don't have good access to internet. So you can access it in the same way you access Wikipedia on very low-end devices without additional costs. Or there are also a lot of SMS platforms which engage young people, but also community representatives. Media, especially the community radio interactive programs, are very effective in emergencies, because they can organize dialogues, can provide feedback, can provide answers to communities. And an important media becomes the hotlines in emergency. It can be local, it can be national, and there can be specific hotlines for specific groups, for example, for migrant and ethnic groups. So I think we are approaching the end of our webinar, and I wanted to provide you a few resources that you can consult. There is the Feedback Starter Kit, Community Engagement and Accountability, and International Federation of the Red Cross. I'm sorry, can you see the presentation now?
Yes, so, we can still see it.
Yeah, sorry. It's a very new tool which was developed recently, and it's very interesting about putting in place a feedback mechanism. Then the practical guidance for risk communication and community engagement. It's also a new resource. And practical guide to working with rumors, from 2017, and Social and Behavior Change Communication for Emergency Preparedness Implementation Kit, developed by John Hopkins. I also provided the links for these resources online, but there are many other resources also. And maybe here we can have a better discussion now about rumors, about opportunities and challenges for you in emergency communication, or maybe you can have suggestions for us what else we should include in this handbook about communication in emergencies. Any volunteers who would like to share with us?
We've got Peter on the platform. Peter, please go ahead and unmute.
Can you hear me?
Yes, yes.
Yeah, my name is Peter. I'm the co-author from Nigeria. I work with CIDA's Refuge Foundation, and also I'm a tobacco control advocate. By the special grace of God, Nigeria is a very special case. When you talk about rumor in Nigeria is deeply profound, that it cut across every sectors of life, and ranging from the grassroots level to the leaders, particularly the political leaders. Institutions by rumors are mostly politically motivated. Just for example, this recent COVID-19 pandemic case, when it all started, we have some governors in Nigeria that actually the effect, and also debunked the existence of COVID-19 in Nigeria. Particularly, you can imagine you governing a mass number of population under you, and you are telling them respectively at your own very state that there is not like COVID-19. And go about your business, don't mind them, you care less about their face masking, care less about social distancing or physical distancing. All you just need to do, go about your business and ensure you'll stay safe. At the end of the day, in some of the states, COVID-19 surfaced in some of the states. And right now, vaccine is here. These same governors are going about to say they are not going to take the vaccine. But the federal government of Nigeria was quick to debunk such rumors. And what they did was they started the vaccination from leaders to ensure believability, whereby the president and the vice president had to take the vaccine on national television, so the whole Nigerian, including those states, can see that if your leaders can take this very vaccine, then you too can take this vaccine, and this vaccine will not kill you. And also, some of these leaders, they also go about spreading rumors as a result of ignorance. Like they say, what you don't know, that ignorance is a voluntary misconception. What you don't know, and you don't want to know it, and you have refused to know it, it will eventually kill you. And number two, some of these leaders, not even the grassroots, not even the middle-class people this time around, these leaders also spread rumors as a result of perceived intelligence. Perceived intelligence. They believe they know it all. They believe your knowledge can add to their own intelligence. This has been a serious issue in Nigeria. And one thing I know for sure, talking about going back to your what we call polio case in Nigeria. And one of the reasons for going against polio immunization then was the Western world are bringing in medicine to stop procreation. The Western world are bringing in medicine to make the women barren. The Western world are bringing medicine to ensure nobody gives birth beyond one or two. And these are very brutal. And not just politically motivated, but they are also traditionally motivated, of which is as a result of what we call ancestral practice. Reject whatever that comes outside, stay with whatever that is within you. And if rumors are coming from leaders, how are we supposed to counter this verity? Because countering this at the stage and at the level of this leadership, it is very expensive. It is very expensive. How are we supposed to really handle this rumor at that very stage? This is also my question. Thank you.
Thank you, Peter. Yes, you are right that it's not easy, and we know it's not easy. The rumors, as we said, can be spread for some political reasons or economic reasons. We will do our best to address them, and you know that they were addressed finally, these rumors. Probably it, in Nigeria. Probably it would have been much easier if they were addressed immediately and not left to grow into something so big. And yes, we don't have always have the perfect answer. We know how many rumors are spread now around about COVID vaccination, but addressing them in time and professionally will help us for sure. Anybody else who wants to speak? And by the way, about this polio vaccination, I myself had to fight the rumors in DRC Congo in 2011, and it took us the same. It took us taking vaccines in front of cameras and minister and expats, leads of UN agencies, taking vaccines in public so that we show that they are not dangerous and we believe in these vaccines. Myself, I took polio vaccines several times on in front of population. Anybody else?
And Nick is back on. And Nick, please go ahead and unmute.
Okay, thank you. C'est une crainte, je voulais exprimer une crainte par rapport justement à ce vaccin COVID-19. Et ma crainte se situe à deux niveaux, toujours concernant les rumeurs. Hein. Même si, ce que l'on observe ces derniers temps, c'est que même si les leaders politiques et les gouvernements se sont prêtés au jeu, c'est-à-dire ont commencé par recevoir eux-mêmes les vaccins, il y a une nouvelle rumeur qui apparaît avec, ça c'est dans les médias sociaux, avec les photos à l'appui selon quoi les vaccins ne sont pas réels, c'est-à-dire qu'ils ne se sont pas réellement fait vacciner. La deuxième chose, c'est concernant les effets du vaccin. C'est-à-dire qu'il y en a qui font...
Annick, tu es disparu? Annick, we cannot hear you.
Okay, let's just move on. And if Annick comes back on, maybe there will be another opportunity. We will still like other people to request to speak, to give comments and feedback.
What Annick said was that there are new rumors. We try to dispel one and new ones come about the vaccine that maybe what we take is not real vaccine and so on. I think we should not forget also to what we said also about social norms, to publicize the change, to show how many people believe in this vaccine, how many people take it, and this changes the way other people also see it. We need to show that people whom they trust this vaccine and take it. Any other volunteers? Annette, do we have anybody else?
No, we don't have anybody else. I'm just checking here. No, nobody else has requested to speak. I think, okay, we have Annick back on. Annick, if you could just finalize your comment.
Hello?
Yes.
J'ai été coupée. Je crois que c'est un problème de de connexion qui n'est pas très stable. Je ne sais pas à quel niveau j'ai été coupée.
Tout au début, tu as dit que parfois, il y a de nouvelles rumeurs, les gens pensent que ce n'est pas le vaccin réel, et après, tu as été coupé.
Voilà, donc ça, c'est la première chose. Les gens pensent que ce n'est pas le vaccin réel ou que les vaccinations sont simulées. La deuxième chose, c'est qu'il y a des réactions, des personnes qui réagissent au vaccin. Et cette rumeur va vite, c'est-à-dire que c'est la sécurité, quelle est la garantie que l'on a qu'on va être... on va pas être exposé, mais protégé par le vaccin. Et l'une des craintes, c'est que le vaccin, c'est deux doses. Donc, la deuxième dose devait être prise dans 2-3 semaines. Quelle est la garantie qu'on aura d'atteindre le même nombre de personnes qui se sont prêtées au jeu, qui ont accepté de recevoir la première dose. Et maintenant, par rapport à ce que Violetta a exposé, c'est-à-dire comment déconstruire la rumeur et proposer un discours qui pousse les gens à l'action. Est-ce qu'en 3 semaines, 2 semaines, on peut, pour ce cas, mettre en œuvre cette stratégie?
Annick, if I may reply, I already tried to reply to your
Donc, j'ai déjà répondu à la première partie de votre question, c'est que concernant la rumeur que le vaccin n'est pas vrai, que les gens
this vaccine and the people whom they trust believe in this vaccine. It's the same as working with social norms. When we said we need to publicize the change, we need to show that people believe, and the country I am now in, this is what happened. In fact, it had one of the very lowest trust in vaccination, and when people started getting the vaccine and trying to get the vaccine and not managing because it's not enough for everybody, the trust in vaccine increased rapidly because people were shown that others whom they respect are looking for this vaccine. For your second point about the reaction, it's the point, the reaction to the vaccination, the side effect. It's the point that we touched today shortly about being transparent. It's very important to tell people, yes, you will have side effects. And what I saw is that speaking largely about, yes, almost everybody has a little fever or this or that or that, but this is a sign that vaccine is effective and helping. It helps a lot. Now people are more prepared in my country, for example, are more prepared and they know that there were side effects almost every time, but they were temporary, short, and this was a sign that the vaccine works. And yes, for the second dose, it's the same reply. If people trust and if we are transparent and tell them that, yes, there will be side effects, but this will reinforce your immunization, then we may convince them that they take the second dose.
Thank you. Thank you.
So thank you very much. So we're coming to an end. Violetta, I don't know if you have got anything else that you want to comment or give feedback before we hand it over to Irina.
Well, I want to thank everybody for the interest in these 3 webinars and to invite again everybody to consult the references that we provided, and especially the handbook on communication for development that we tried to present to you through these 3 webinars.
Hello, Violetta. I think I have a question.
Yes, please.
Yeah, the question is, according to Rome Consensus in 2006, when the World Congress on Communication for Development organized by United Nations made some recommendation about national development policies, which must include specific communication for development component. And these actually made communication for development very critical and very key in all development strategies around the world today. And the question is, why don't we have a strengthened partnership and network at the international, national, maybe local level to advance communication for development and improve outcome? It is very key, because if I search the real, because I haven't searched today, I don't think we have any network for communication development and stuff around the world today, even in Africa, Europe, in the America, or even in Nigeria. I don't know if you people can help us kickstart it, coordinate it for us, so at least we opt in and start making good use of all this good work and the rest. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Peter. And actually, we need to clarify a thing here. This, when we say communication for development, is the same as saying social and behavior change communication. So the UN agencies prefer to say communication for development, but there are so many other organizations around that call it social and behavior change communication, and we don't have any differences. So there is a global alliance, which is called Alliance for Social Change, and there are congresses of this in social and behavior change. The last one, I think third or fourth, was supposed to happen last year in spring in Morocco and Marrakesh, and it was postponed because of the pandemic, but it will happen at some moment. I think you should, maybe I will make a list of links also I will send to Holly, and she will share with all of you to have access to resources that are, that, for example, on the Communication Initiative website and others, that so that you have access to registering to this global forum and participating in the discussions that are happening all the time. Yes, we would like, of course, to have a much larger platform and much more participation, but for the moment, this global alliance is the one that is leading the discussions in this area. I will provide the links so that they are shared together with the presentation.
Thank you very much, Violeta. Irina, over to you.
Thank you very much, Annette and Violeta. Thank you. It's a very, very interesting presentation today. And I think that not only it's wrapped up the three webinars, but most importantly, it opens a new field and a totally new perspective around communication for development and its role during emergencies, in conflicts, and in fragile settings. And what I would like to say here, perhaps also to respond to Peter in a way or another, is that this is a very new field for us in CV registration and vital statistics. Very few steps have been taken in very few countries around this. As you could see, even during the presentation today, the majority of the examples come from public health, they were from vaccinations. I believe that there are a few others around child soldiers or children associated with armed forces and groups, and perhaps on children reunifications in children in emergencies, you know, work around how do we ensure that children who are separated from families are coming back, they have proper documentation and so on and so forth. All this to say, I think that this webinar and a new e-learning course that the Center of Excellence will be offering soon in this area, an e-learning course around communication for development in conflict, fragile, and emergency settings, will actually contribute to setting on solid footing this field into the CRVS global arena. What I also want to say is that this is something which have not been researched until the Center of Excellence has decided to contribute by revising the Handbook on Communication for Development for CV Registration and Vital Statistics Systems and Identity Management Systems. So we are all at the very beginning. These are good news and bad news. Bad news on the side that we do not really have examples. So we have to create examples, and we would be very grateful to you if you have any examples on CRVS from your countries, please do send these to us. We are going to make use of them during our e-learning course, and they would be beneficial for all your colleagues. And write straight to the Center of Excellence or to Violeta, to whomever you feel more comfortable with. But it's also good news because it means that with what we have learned during these three webinars, we can actually innovate, right? And we have seen what are the important features of the communication in emergency, conflict, and fragility settings, right? It has to be nationally led and coordinated, community-centered and participatory, like all these new approaches in CV registration and vital statistics, where we are having the human-centered design at the core of systems development, we should have community-centered and participatory approaches in all communication for development for increased demand for the services. Communication has to be informed even in these special settings by data about the community, the needs, the issues, and the perceptions. It has to, you know, respond to misinformation, disinformation, and rumors, and nurture trust, be open and transparent, and all-inclusive, in particular for all vulnerable and marginalized groups. So we have also heard what are the important steps in terms of preparedness, what are the expected results, how to anticipate and minimize them, impact, how to build alliances and networks and manage communication risks. So a lot of new things, which again have the population at the center, right? What the population needs and what the system needs, and it's always a very fragile balance. And where does this meet, and how do we bring this forward together? We have seen also with Violeta examples from, for example, COVID-19, recent emergencies. And I think that if you go back to your countries, perhaps one of your thinking could be how this COVID-19 and the rumors and the fear factor has impacted CV registration systems, if at all. Have people gone to our services? If yes, why? And if not, why they have not gone? And these are really critical questions into the after COVID-19. How do we build stability? You know, durable solutions and sustainable systems, right? So we have seen really a lot. It has been a lot of food for thought for all of us about different things, about how to do it, what to do, what not to do, what kind of communication to put together, and also perhaps food for thought for all of us and how do we see this aligning and unrolling at your country level. All this to say, communication for development is an overlooked area into CV registration and vital statistics systems at country level, also at regional level and at country level. It depends only on you in convincing and advocating for communication to be including into the national strategies on CRVS system strengthening and development beyond money for the phones and for the tablets. It depends only on you actually to be creative and build evidence-based measurable communication for development plans that contribute to increased demand and sustainable systems. And of course, which all have at their basis data, evidence, and research. With this, thank you very much to all for having been so patient with us for the last three webinars. I see a lot of names who are coming back. Thank you so much to Violeta and to Dorina who have worked on these webinars, and Violeta who has, you know, relentlessly delivered them. Annette and the team in Ottawa for all of it. And we look forward to hearing back from you around these areas with examples and what you are planning to do at the country level. Good luck to all, and thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Irina. Also a big thank you from me to Violeta and for all of you to joining us for this webinar. And again, you know, stay tuned. We're going to come out with an e-learning self-paced course where we will present some of the same slides and learnings in a couple of months' time. I also just want to say that next week we're having another webinar about construction foundation for legal identity in post-conflict settings, where you will be able to experience different countries, Rwanda, South Africa, Afghanistan, and Georgia, and understand their strategy to reach everybody with legal identity from birth. So for me, for this time, thank you and goodbye.
Thank you. Have a nice day, everyone.
Bye.
Bye.